little reminder is needed. Another hero lies dead. Tulok approached the flesh-warping machinery with eagerness to confront who he suspected lay within. And in response came Volok, dedicated consort of Belcora, artist, abomination, murderer. Now swarming with cockroaches in addition to his leeches and coughing up spiders as he spoke, Volok spit threats of death and destruction for being interrupted in his plans yet again. Tulok stood his ground with Krukka and Gilda at his back and promised the same in return. Vengeance would be theirs. Immediately, Volok overwhelmed the heroes with his new power, and the heroes, already worn from their battle with Jafaki, begrudgingly began to retreat. However, Volok cut them off with his translocation magic, and Tulok fell to the biting swarms that were all over his body. With quick help from Krukka and a direct assault and healing from Gilda, Tulok was able to rise and continue his retreat. Volok then rolled a mysterious object at the heroes, which summoned a creature made of black smoke. While Krukka tried to handle this creature, it turned out to be invulnerable. And with this distraction, Volok lashed out at Gilda, springing black tentacles from every surface. They grabbed the paladin of Aurori and squeezed her unconscious. While Krukka continued his retreat, Tulok tried to use the power of his skeletal giant to wrench Gilda free. But it was for naught, as Volok pressed the power of a killer phantasm into her mind and took her life. Her final vision, a nightmare of failure, of the deaths of her companions, of her own wasted death. If only she knew the truth.
Tulok and Krukka are sitting in a room with a fire blazing, a magical fire that doesn't give off a comforting warmth, but even if it did, it might not be very comfortable or comforting anyway. Maybe Krukka is lounging on a disused and broken down divan. Maybe Tulok is at the teleportation circle looking over the runes. But regardless of what they're doing, I would imagine their minds are stewing on the very, very recent memory of losing Lady Gilda to Volok, another victim to that recurring villain. Krukka ran, but he had the chance. He did stop and he tried and he saved Tulok, but when all hope was lost, he ran. How he feels about that, oof, I would like to know, Duncan. Tulok stood a little bit longer. His last few moments doing everything he can, sustaining that animate dead spell, that skeletal giant doing its best to rip Lady Gilda free from those black tentacles, even after her death trying to pull that body away. But with the looming threat of just around the corner, blind to what Valak is doing, that skeletal champion couldn't do the job, and Tulok also had to go, also had to follow those footsteps of Krukka, especially with the giant mass of who knows what the hell in that arena starting to move and head towards you. It likely would have cut off your passage very quickly. After a couple extra attempts of pulling at those tendrils, Tulok, for the first time, uses a new spell, the spell that saw and was part of the orchestration of Lady Gilda's death, just to get out of there as fast as possible before he lost himself, dimension doored across the arena to those stairs that Krukka went up. Now, I assume Krukka waited for him at the top of the stairs, but there was little time to waste, because who knows what kind of reach and ability that big mass has, and you're still on the open upper floor balcony of the arena. So they both made their way through what they know about this arena floor and back to the room just outside of Shafkim's office. And there they stand, sit, rest, and restlessly consider what the hell just happened. And meanwhile, you just hear the light crackling of embers and fire in the fireplace, no matter how unreal that fire might be, and the persistent shuffling of feet and parchment from Shafkim's office as he continues to prepare to leave. How are you feeling, and what do you do?
I think I speak for everybody when I say, fuck you, Bairn.
Yep, we were all thinking it.
Yep. For the record, James is here with us. Well, we might not be on mic for the moment.
Stewing,
plotting my death. The end, you know, planning it for the end of the podcast run, I'm sure.
I haven't seen what he's drinking, but it's probably some brown liquor.
He said it was strong.
It is. It is two fingers of Jameson.
That's a home pour if I've ever seen one.
Whose fingers?
Yeah. All right, well.
I think Krukka is feeling like a coward, and because he doesn't know how to face that, and not willing to face Tulok, who he ran away from after saving, but he ran, he'd just start by going to Shafkim, opening the door and just looking at him blankly and saying, Jafiki is dead.
Oh, good news indeed. Yes. Thank you for that.
I believe there was talk of some reward.
Oh, yes, of course. Sorry, I'm so caught up in my preparations. Here, allow me.
And he grabs a bit of parchment with something written all over it, and he flips it over with its blank on one side, and he starts to draw, like, really quickly draws, like, some rather elaborate and detailed, like, shapes and walls and lines, and he basically draws you a detailed map, including all of the secret doors and rooms for this level and the level below, for the arena and the laboratories. Showing you anything and everything that might be there and what you might have missed. And he hands it to you.
My gift to you, the ability to sort out and root through these levels that I was once administrator of. Who knows what sort of secrets might be hidden throughout.
And when you grab it, Kruk, you flip it over, you can see there's a very elaborate, detailed formula of some kind on the back, but you don't quite understand it. But he seems not to, care. Just hands it to you, but perhaps there's a little more value to it.
Tulok is watching blankly as this is happening, tears streaming down his cheeks. And he just kind of shakes his head. He says, "Trinkets and hand-drawn notes? This is what you give us? For doing your dirty work? While you prepare yourself to be a plague in Osirian when you head home? You are foul. Even more foul than I thought. I thought the enemy of my enemy was my friend. But you are a disgusting creature. Just as bad as he was." And Tulok is approaching, angry, tears hot on his face. And he reaches forward and touches him on the head and casts Join Pass.
On Shafkum?
Yes.
Ooh-hoo.
Okay. Do I have to be a willing creature for that? That's pretty forward.
Goddamn right. Targets, forehead.
Up to two willing creatures.
Two willing creatures. Okay. Well, is he willing to see? Because he would potentially know what spell was.
Yeah, he steps back. He's like,
"Careful, boy. Careful. I can see you're a little worse for wear. And your companion absent. I can appreciate such frustration. But I am not the one to take it out on. Especially not in your delicate state."
Tulok slams the door.
Oh. Now that door's mangled. You can't really slam that door. It was all bounded in with pitons. You had to pry it all apart.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yes, Freeman, I'm just mad you didn't yes and me there.
I know. Well, you just walk up and touch people on the forehead aggressively. he says,
"Listen, perhaps if it would help, I could give you the rituals in which we could create the undead. Perhaps your companion might return to you as I have returned myself to the mortal world."
"Undead is not life."
"Yes, indeed. But it is continuation, at least. Might be a bit of a darker offering. But those secrets I have, and they are yours, if what I give you now is not enough."
Tulok pulls his hand back, maybe realizing what he's doing a little bit more out of the daze. Says, "I've told you you're foul. If I know anything about Lady Gilda, she would never sink to the depths that you have. I think it's time you take your leave." And he turns his back on him.
"Oh, I plan to, Master Tulok. Very soon, you could leave me in memories past, as I will you in this place."
And after Tulok turns his back, Krakow will actually manage to lower his voice a little and say, "This is the second companion he has lost to this Volok. It's truly, truly foul. If there is any information or anything that may be his undoing."
"Volok, you say? Did not mention him before. He is still alive."
"I do not know if I would call what he has life, but it is not death, and I wish for that more than anything."
"Now that is intriguing. He was once, I must say, one of the most handsome men I have ever seen."
"You're no looker yourself."
"Yes, the ritual of mummification will do that. Tell me, is he still the handsome man he once was?
How do you feel about a mass of spiders, leeches, and cockroaches as handsome?
Not so much for me, I suppose.
Different strokes.
Interesting, though. There's few rituals in the world that can conduct such a transformation.
How about rituals that can undo them?
A very rare circumstance, I would say. I can't say I know of any, but I do recall that the want or need for redemption and reversal are required for such a thing. I doubt very much you would find that with someone like Volok Hazrene. Someone so proud. And I'm sure now filled to the brim with shame.
I guess we'll just have to be as persuasive as we can. And he'll turn and rejoin Tulak.
And Shachem just goes back to work. Doing his thing. Nearly at the end of that final day for him to make his leave. What you've uncovered from, or what you've received from Shafkim, can show you that on this floor, the only thing you have not looked at is the hallway and room north of where you saw the Velstrak, with the rusty chains.
Which we already knew about that motherfucker.
You already knew that was up there, yeah. But you've discovered all other secrets, I guess is the point. As for the labs below, you have some obvious hallways to uncover as well. But you have not... you've found any secrets already as well. Now, that being said, he has also annotated very quickly a lot of these rooms of what they used to be. So you can kind of get a feel for their original purposes if you feel it's necessary and ask, and maybe it helps you understand what might be ahead of you.
Volok's bathroom on there. We can catch him on the shitter.
Wouldn't that be nice? His personal latrine.
Yeah. The formula on the back of the map, was that in a language anybody can read?
Yeah, it's something you can discern. However, it is you can quickly understand that it is effectively a spell scroll for a very particular spell.
Is it an occult spell?
Sure is.
Is it a devolification spell?
Not far off. Because it is Compel True Name.
Ooh.
Which I don't know when the last time you looked at that, Scott.
Been a while, because I don't have it.
It's a pretty significant spell. Now, I messaged you a little while ago, I mean a couple weeks ago, or a month ago at this point, about the fact that you actually, even though you're a spontaneous caster, you can actually learn spells from scrolls, but you have to, like, the idea is that if it's an uncommon or rare spell for you, that's why it's most important. This is an uncommon spell, or a rare spell even, I think. Yeah, it's a rare spell. And it allows you, if you have to roll a check, and then on your next level up, you can add it to your repertoire, where normally you might not be able to without GM approval. So this is me throwing this at you, like, this is a reward, like, you are now able to get this. But you need to progress a little bit further still. But it is exactly the sort of thing that should pair very well with what you have now. Something I'm sure you sorely wish you had before the recent events, but there was no way of doing it without having finished your goal of killing Jaffaki. You're welcome. You're welcome for that.
Yeah, thank you. I actually, it's just funny because that was something that I was looking at when I did my last level up, mm-hmm. and was thinking about taking anyway at the next level up, because I had to take the remove curse last time, and I was really excited for Dimension Door and Phantasmal Killer, which were the three I took. And so I was like, okay, let's keep going down the true name thing. So when I hit fifth level and I get my other fourth level, I was going to take it anyway. So,
yeah. And here's, I'm actually going to do something with this too, because we've kind of done the true name thing a little bit differently than Raw, in that you're supposed to be able to do research towards true names and then learn them and then do them for like any number of creatures as long as you put the footwork in, yada, yada, yada. But right at the beginning of this podcast, you and I agreed that I would allow us to go down the road. However, I would restrict it for a purpose. And it would be, you know, instead of you just doing the research on all these different creatures and getting it, gaining an advantage for certain ones, I really wanted to weave it into the story. So that's what we're doing. That's what we're doing with that. And what I want to do is basically give this to you. This will be something in addition to your normal amount of spell repertoire.
Yeah.
So this is once you level up and you're able to like study this scroll and understand the concept of compel true name spell, this is one extra spell than you would normally get.
Yes.
So that's like a pretty big bonus, but it is for, we're basically, this is Volok only instead of whatever we can. And that's what I wanted to roll with. So your next level, whatever you get all the choices that you would normally get and you can pick whatever you want. And then you get this as a bonus on top, which is pretty sweet. I think
I'm still mad at you.
I know. I can tell he's not like not feeling that appreciative right now, but later on, I'm sure.
Where's my consolation prize?
Yeah, exactly.
Where are you showing up to my window with the boombox over your head, Freeman?
Let me just check the Foundry compendium for things for cowards.
Oh, god damn.
Get a nice yellow-bellied shirt.
Tulok looks at the scroll, and as he's deciphering it, he turns to Krukka and says, if only we had this before. This is something that truly could have helped against Volok, but we didn't get it in time. Who knows what it could have brought us?
If we had never learned of this place in the first place, who knows what it would have brought us? There's no sense questioning it now.
I suppose you're right. It's another name to the list that this place has claimed. Lady Gilda saved us many times before. And she did again today. I hope she's at peace. I hope in her last moment, she realized just how much she did for us and how much we care for her. And knows that we got away safe.
And Krukka, having basically seen her last moments, is not going to say a word.
That's fucking heartbreaking. Because we know that's not the case. Oh, God.
Yeah.
The meta is brutal. Oh, man.
Speaking of meta, what the fuck are we going to do?
So Tulok tucks the map into his pocket and he turns to Krukka and says, I know we left her there, but we have to go back. If not now, then soon, but I don't feel right leaving her body there. I feel like we need to rest and we need to go back and save her body before Volok does something vile to it, corrupts it. I don't know. But I feel drawn to get her body.
Yes, agreed. I'd rather leave things between us, having only fought alongside her.
So, yeah, Tulok wants to rest full 8 hours or 10 or whatever we need to get the...
Yeah.
Or with two, it's even more. It's a long time.
I mean, that's if you want to take watch, right? It's if you don't want to, you try to find a safe place, lock yourself in kind of thing and take the chance, I guess. You kind of have the floor below with the room with the weird keys.
Yeah, well, good luck.
One normal key and the other weird key.
Yeah. Yeah, except the only thing is that Tulok's worried about going down there because that's where Volok is and they're injured. So if anything, maybe they would flee up a level, find somewhere safe, rest, recoup, get spells back, get health back, and then go down.
Yeah, sure do wish I had that compass from Lady Gilda right now.
Oh, yeah. I actually kind of forgot. All that.
This Krekka is hurt. Damn. He's going to have to do it.
So many goods. Yeah, I guess meta-wise, it might make more sense, even though it's painful, to go back to town, lighten your loads, because you know you're going to have to go pick up a bunch of shit. Not just Lady Gil's body, but like all the stuff that she's got on her.
That's true. And yeah, it could get really hairy just trying to dive right back in there.
Okay. Does Krekka smart? Does he say any of this to Tulok?
Yes.
Nice.
Yeah. Okay. So they'll, as they're just sitting there in contemplation, they'll kind of like feel the weariness kind of set upon him because he's fucking hurt. We may want to go back to town and make some preparations. I feel trying to face this dungeon just between the two of us, it's beyond us.
And Tulok looks up at Krekka and, you know, just his shoulders slump again as the adrenaline is coming down and the weariness hits him as well. He says, I suppose you're right. We can come back. We did it for Samal. It'll be okay. And he stands and gestures towards the teleportation circle.
And as Krekka walks behind him, he'll mutter, I did not say it will be okay.
All right. And then they hit the teleportation circle. Purple magic emanating from Tulok's arms and lighting up the room. And they appear just below the surface and head into town.
Sorry, just for clarification, you rested before that or no?
No rest.
You head straight to town. Okay, cool. That makes the most sense to me. Okay, I'm going to fast forward some time here on the calendar. Try and keep up to date here. off air, guys, we've had a little more confusion. Thanks, calendar and myself not being able to use it. We'll say you get back to town. I mean, it's still pretty early in the day, which is crazy. So you're coming in like early morning. The town is bustling. It's about nearly 9 o'clock in the morning. And everyone's kind of getting their day started as you wander in, you know, very worse for wear. It's been a bit like recording wise, episode wise, because this is part of what we were talking about off air is that, you know, once you realize you had a time limit with Shafkim, you really tried not to rest and really tried not to go back to town.
Right. And so we went back to town and it was the full moon night.
Yeah, that was the last time you were. So you spent the whole night fighting, stayed up all night to like help heal everyone, and then I think you rested the day, and then you sent your letter home, and Lady Gilda sent off for a shield, and then you went back in, and you've rested once inside the dungeon since then, as far as I know, something along those lines.
Man, if you were just like, I know it's one thing for us because it's like dozens of episodes and, you know, lots of time in between weeks and weeks and weeks. But like, if you're a townsperson, it's like, we're like leaving for a day and then coming back and someone's dead.
Yeah. And they're just going about their business in town, you know, like it's crazy. It is bonkers. Yeah. We're still, let me just check here. We are still less than a month in game time.
Yikes.
And do the town folk know that Carmen is dead?
No. The last time you talked to anyone about it was before the night of the full moon and all that. And because the full moon took everyone's attention. You never had the conversation. You went straight back in. So no one has any idea you even found Carmen, let alone that he's died.
Well, okay. And the cooperative blade is still on Lady Gilda in the dungeon.
Yep. So. Which, according to the mayor, at least, and belongs in the Dawnflower Library.
Okay. So they head back into town. And on the outskirts of town, Tulok turns to Krukka and says, "I'm tired. I need to go sleep. Where will you go?"
"I will go home and rest."
"Okay. Keep good thoughts in your mind. Do not let the sadness corrupt you. Let's meet tomorrow. Tomorrow morning. In the market."
"Weren't we coming home like midday? Early morning? Midday?"
"Yeah."
"So just sleep it off."
Yeah, because I'm like, what are we going to do at night, you know?
"I'm probably going to need several healing checks."
"Or I guess we could, fuck it. We can just, why don't we just, okay. Actually, meet in the evening." Tula says, "Let's meet in the evening, again at the market, and whoever we need to wake, whatever we need to do, they will wake. And we will take care of business. We need to get Lady Gilda from that place of darkness as soon as we can."
"Agreed."
"Yeah, we could forgo healing checks. We don't have to go through that process."
"I'm just thinking time-wise."
"Yeah, time-wise, like, so, you know, you're going to rest for 8 hours, which is going to bring you around, you know, nearly 5 in the evening when you're done resting. We can tag on, I'm just going to tag on till 5 for some extra time to make up for healing checks, to make it easy. So we'll call it 5 p.m. 1700 hours is when you are ready to meet up again. So the town is still awake and bustling in a way that the work day is coming to an end soon. When you make your way into town, do you just sort of subtly, I mean, I guess Krukka probably goes to his own little hut in the forest. Maybe Tulok just try to subtly, like, just enter town and go unnoticed kind of thing.
Tulok casts invisibility on himself.
Oh, yeah.
And walks through town completely unnoticed.
Slinks right in there.
Imagine that's like a weird sight where it's like, you know, you disappear, but like, you know, imagine like a TV show or whatever, and you're invisible and you're like walking along, and at some point you must like get distracted. You almost bump into someone, or you do bump into someone. They're like, "What the fuck was that?" You know, like, "What the hell?" And like, yeah, but you're just so like zoned out and haggard and exhausted, you know, you just keep
have you ever
on.
Been like really sad in public? You know, for whatever reason, whether you got broken up with someone or you just found out someone had passed away or something like that. Yeah. And you are crushed, but just everybody around you is going about their business and you're kind of like
numb.
Walking through and numb.
Yeah.
And it's just like, at least he had that invisibility. Mm-hmm. So it's just, there's no, as if anyone would like, I don't know who would notice or what, but just like the no notice. And he can just,
I imagine like, you know, maybe a bump into someone by mistake, or, you know, you kick something that got, you know, rock that goes rolling and it confuses someone, or someone hears a bit of a, like a whimper or a sob out of you as you're walking, but no one can quite pinpoint any of it. And it's very strange. And like the town's already filled with anxiety, you know, from the event of the graveyard and then the event of the full moon, you know, so there's an anxiety there that's, you know, people are feeling really superstitious and stuff. So you're not really helping the cause in that. But, you know, it's not something that's top of your priorities right now. Numb is probably the best word for it, really.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, so you guys rest, recover. It's about 5 in the evening and you meet up again at the market. And one of the most notable things about the market, as you didn't notice when you get to your little caravan, Tulok, but as you emerge to meet with Krukka, you notice there are wolf pelts strung up all over the place as trophies, as decoration, as victory. And there's a bit of a cheery mood in a way, despite the anxiety in the market especially.
So Tulok exits his caravan and he sees Krukka and kind of hurriedly walks over to him, definitely ignoring any sort of merriment that's around. And he says, I don't know where to go first. Talk to Vandy. Talk to Rin. I'm at a loss. And he's still looking heartbroken.
Yeah. Krukka just pauses and, well, I'm not sure myself, but Rin seems to have given us guidance in the past.
Agreed.
Perhaps she can read the stars.
And Tulok, with his hood up, kind of brushes away and heads in that direction.
Just before you start to walk away, and as you turn to do so, you realize that a very small gathering of people has like formed nearby and like cutting you off. And they're holding, so a couple of them are holding like this kind of big package that's wrapped in parchment. And it's a bit heavy, and they've recognized you, and they're a little bit surprised to see you again, but they're like, you know, they have that sense of delight, you know, because you are the heroes, right? They may not realize Lady Guild is gone, but like, they know it's Tulok. They recognize Krukka. Like, and one of them is just like, Master Tulok, Krukka, we've been waiting for you to return. Do you have a quick moment?
Tulok looks to Krukka as if to say, please take care of this.
Okay. Krukka cocks an eyebrow. A quick moment.
Okay. And they kind of like excitedly approach Krukka at least. Tulok, do you plan to like just like slip away from that or?
No, I mean, I think that he just kind of takes a few steps backwards and is just watching, but again, still kind of numb and just, you know, maybe slightly interested as well, but just not wanting to be a part of it.
Yeah. You basically start getting like little bits of like praise and stuff like that. Like, thank you so much for what you've done. Like, you know, you've done such great work for Otari. We can't thank you enough. You've saved us all. Yeah. I'm all these platitudes, right?
Strong.
Yeah. And it probably feels hollow in a way, you know? And, like, a couple of them are directed at you too, Tulok, since you're still there. But they are feeling a genuine joy at your presence. And they just see heroes in you. They can't not give you all of these generous compliments and thanks. And they hand this package to you, Krukka. And they said, after the night of the full moon, you were promised that we would give you something, that we would make something for you, using the pelt. Sorry, I forget what it's called.
Wolf wrapper, yes.
Using the pelt of the winter wolf.
The wolf wrapper.
And here it is. It's for you. I think for you, Master Krukka, it'll be very, very useful.
Thank you. And he will not tip.
You bastard. And as this package is handed to you, the everyone kind of like slowly disperses, you know, but like very what's they're looking for? Reluctantly. Because they're still very excited, but they kind of want to leave you alone because they're starting to get the vibe that you're like you're preoccupied. But Tulok, you can see if you're kind of trying to pay attention at all, you notice Kilino Lathanar is not far away, and he's in a wheelchair. He's not like, you know, hasn't lost the ability to walk, but he's still in recovery. You know, from he got hit real bad, and you saved his life, and he's got like a caretaker just moving him around the market a bit, you know, so he can still keep watch on his business. And He looks a bit weak, a little bit worse for wear, but he kind of like just gives you one of those real respectful at a long distance, like lock your eyes and give you a nod kind of thing. So no, you've had run-ins with him before. He didn't really respect what you did, and he's always been a real, real rough, angry kind of person and businessman. But something's changed given the events. And even if it's not a big handshake and thank you, I think Tulak recognizes the significance of it.
Certified Kalathanod.
Kalathanod! Certified, stamped and everything.
And Tulak, through his pain, nods back because he knows that Kalino, of all people, knows loss.
Yeah.
But if the crowd begins to dismiss and move away, Tulak will turn and silently just head towards Rinz.
Okay.
Kruga tries to look excited about the wolf thing and just kind of like smiles with his mouth but not his eyes in a way that probably looks really, really weird, and then follows Tulak.
Okay.
What is the item?
Yeah, can I try it on?
Yeah, so you sort of open it up, and it's like a sort of this strange set of hide armor. And it comes with a little sheet of details on it, so that you don't have to bother rolling a check here. But this is basically what you call wolf jaw armor.
Ooh.
It is so it's known for, like, barbarians and druids and other outlanders are often forced to spend the harsh winter months protecting their communities from one of the deadliest predators to stalk the forests and taiga of the northern reaches, which is the fearsome winter wolf. This is a +1 hide armor, and it is assembled from hide and fur of a trio of winter wolves. So the way I've ruled this story-wise, is that Kilian already had two pelts. He had spent a great amount of money on acquiring them just for his thirst of dead wolves. And the third one was the winter wolf you killed when fighting what's-his-dude. Basically, the armor conveys the wearer with an attack akin to the winter wolf's deadly jaws, and the ability to channel the frigid cold of the winter wolf's breath weapon.
Ooh.
This is a level 7 armor. I'm going to throw it in your inventory real quick, Kruka, once I find your character.
Little fire and ice thing going.
right? This may not be the best thing for your armor-wise. It's in your inventory now. I'm actually not sure. But it has a 2-action interact activate, which is the cold trait, and it's once per day. You can do a 15-foot cone with a basic reflex save for 5d8 cold damage.
Okay.
You could also do a single action interact once per hour, and it causes your unarmed attacks to become jaw attacks. So, like, basically the sleeve of this suit of armor is like a wolf's jaws. So it goes over your hand kind of thing, and you can, like, jaw attack with your arm. And it deals 1d8 piercing +1 cold damage. And has the brawling, group, and trip and unarmed traits where necessary. So on the item, there's an effect that you can add to your person if you need to.
This could be a lot of fun. I mean, it's the same AC bonus, but
is it
a -5 speed penalty? But with the sudden charge that I use so often, I kind of like overcome that speed penalty. Like, it's very pretty rare I'm using my full complement of actions or full complement.
Oh, it's a -5 speed penalty. That's interesting. I didn't see that coming. But yeah, you should be okay with that. For a hide armor, it's medium armor, I guess. Oh, it's medium armor. That's probably why, because you're wearing light armor now. I didn't realize this was going to be a medium because it's hide. Interesting. But yeah, it's a pretty cool item, and I can tell you that this is, as of this recording, a very recently added item to the plethora of items for Pathfinder 2E, because it came from the Treasure Vault book, which was recently released. It's not actually a part of the adventure.
Oh, neat.
Well, but I thought it was appropriate.
Well, because you put all that work in, he's going to wear it out.
Thank you. Also, there's I'm quite sure there's artwork for this, and it looks really silly. So I'm going to find it and send it to you guys. It's like fun silly, but it's kind of silly. In any case, that is what you have received as a reward for your efforts on the Night of the Full Moon, which I feel like is now the new name for it. I didn't plan that. It's the Night of the Full Moon. What an event.
It only happens 12 to 14 times a year.
No big deal. But yeah, you head on back to, or head on over to Rinz then from here, eh?
It was a lot different than the full moon parties I've been to before.
Oh boy. Oh boy. Yeah, I don't even want to know. Don't even want to know.
And yeah, head to Rinz.
Okay.
Speaking of full moon, go to the sky and the stars and stuff.
The caravan of the cosmos.
Sorry, one sec. I just want to... Oh, yeah, here we go. Just want to see the picture real quick.
Yeah, that's dumb.
It's a bit silly.
I love it. I love the use of his left hand.
Oh, yeah. You expect the wolf jaws to be like around the head area, but no, it's...
No, it's an activate. You have to one action activate to make it that. The jaws over your arm, so you know you don't lose.
Oh, okay. So one action to pull your sleeves down is what you're saying.
Basically, yeah.
I don't know why, but it gives me mad vibes of like, you know, the bearskin rug in the Addams Family that would like bite
people. Oh yeah. Yeah. That's good. All right, so you head to getting back to the game, you head to Rin's Wonders, and Rin is you do your usual walk up and kind of tap in one of the standing stones out of politeness and enter through a curtain. And Rin is already pouring a cup of tea. Well, three cups of tea, sorry.
And Tulok enters and Rin, we come bearing bad news again. The lady has fallen. Saving us from an evil that is so unmistakably cruel, but she saved us from it. The same evil that took Physic from us. Volok. He's even more powerful now. And he just bows his head. Struggling to find words.
She solemnly gestures for both of you to sit and have some tea. And sits down herself. Head hung.
I had the briefest of visions. I knew something was wrong. This is... a great loss. I almost fear the marching of an Andorian army over it. But even if that is true, we cannot wait for it to arrive.
Rin, when we began this quest, not a month ago, I knew it'd be hard. I knew there was danger. Death. We lost them all so quickly. But I could not expect this. Question my abilities as all my companions fall around me and I have not been able to save them, to bring them back. All my power does is kill and distort and create darkness, much like we already see down there. I don't bring light into this world. I don't bring healing or saving. I bring more death.
Tulok, I also did not expect so much. I bear a double burden. I did not know I was asking this much of you. And I did not know that that I would have to sit idly by to watch it for my own weaknesses. I feel I am to blame for most of this. Yet, we must know what remains true, not subjectively, not emotionally. None of this is our fault. None. This is our world. I have seen the raising of towns from Tree Razor himself. We live in a world with looming evil and danger all the time. And innocence is what we protect. Those of us who can. We all have our burden. I am truly sorry to both of you that this is yours. And that Gilda and Fisik and Samal have carried the heaviest weight of it.
And Tulok is sitting with his head hung, and he has his hands in front of his face and clenches them as purple sparks kind of appear and apparate as he clenches his fists, just like electricity running through him of the magic. And a tear rolls down his cheek, and he says, "You may be right. You are right. It doesn't ease my pain. Seeing all these people alive doesn't ease my pain. Because they don't know what we've gone through down there. And they will never know what we've done to save this town. And we haven't even saved it yet. Every step we take feels like 2, 3, 4, 5 steps backwards. Everything is harder and more brutal and more evil and more despicable the farther we go down. I hope there's light at the end, Rin. I pray for light."
Otari has seen much. It is special. It has lived through its first construction, and then its destruction, and then rebuild. It has faced minor things like kobolds compared to what we have. It faces political and financial tyrants like the Cortos Consortium. But what stands out around here is the people. They band together. They prepare. They trust in what you are doing. And if you continue it, they will be further bolstered. For every step you feel is backwards while you are in those vaults, know that everyone here takes 2 steps forward. They gain ground for you and with you. You are not alone, though you are separate.
And Tulok with this raises his eyes and says, "You're right. These are my people. I do know every single person here. And they're not bad. They mean well." He turns to Krukka. He says, "Krukka, you were an outsider before this. And you have helped us so much. If this burden has become too much to bear, you do not have to continue with us. I do not want to ask you, but I know that you are a brother to me because of our time together, short as it may have been. And you have fought valiantly beside us and saved my life. You just saved my life. And I forever appreciate that. But if you don't want to come, it is okay.
At this point, from what I have seen, there is no going back. It's not your fault, Rin. It's not your fault, Tulok. It's not my fault. It's not the town's fault, but it's happening nonetheless. And it needs to be seen to the finish. Whatever that path may be, I will be taking it.
Tulok smiles, and there's nothing that he wants more than to be joined by Krukka as they carry on in the Abomination Vaults. And he truly is thankful for the fact that he knows he saved him, and he hasn't spent the time to properly thank him, but it's there.
Get him the latest Dan Brown novel.
This might be above your level of reading, but here's Dan Brown's latest.
Oh, he's very smart, too.
You depart from Rin's?
No.
No?
We do not.
Okay. All right.
Tulok will ask Rin to seek out the Cosmic Caravan for them that evening.
Okay.
And to ask if they will be successful in retrieving Lady Gilda's body if they go back this evening.
She's going to, for the first time in a very long time, read the stars! Okay, here we go. It's been a while since I looked at this, but I know it is a check I have to roll. Oh God, how does this work? Once per day. She waits for nightfall. You all wait for nightfall, and the stars start to peek out. And she performs this reading the stars sort of ritual, and she's going to attempt an astrology lore check. That's what it is. Astrology lore, and the DC. Oh, okay. The DC is appropriate for the player's current level. Oh, I love that. DC for level 7. Oh my god, I thought it was 40 for a second there. That sounded crazy. okay.
Just 4.
She reads the stars as best she can. And she succeeds, giving her the effects of the augury spell. Something that we did very early on. And so you basically gain a vague glimpse of the future. During the casting of the spell, ask about the results of a particular course of action, which you have. The spell can predict results up to 30 minutes in the future. Reveals the GM's best guess among the following outcomes. Wheel, woe, wheel and woe, and nothing. So,
30 minutes in the future? That sounds fucking dumb.
Yeah, I mean, that's the best she can do with her success on the roll here. But you can take it as you will, right? Like, she could tell you that 30 minutes from now, it may, you know, she'll get something.
But when we used it before, we talked about, like, something that night. It was never 30 minutes, was it?
So you've also done this before and critically succeeded, and it was the effects of the Read Omen spell, which was much more powerful. Yeah. So that being said, though, like,
but that's like, is it going to be a nice fucking walk back to the stupid fucking Abomination Vaults while we're walking down the trail? Like,
Sure.
Ooh, thank you so much, Rin.
But like, he's so fucking sassy. Jesus. Let me speak.
I apologize. Go ahead, Barnes.
You know, just imagine this, though. Like, you know, the question you've asked is like, you know, will we be able to recover, you know, Lady Gil's body safely, you know? And you can, I feel like it's easy to interpret that in this sense, in that is the current state of the area around Lady Gilda's body a safe place in which to recover it. And that has nothing to do with whether or not you could reach there in 30 minutes, so much as within the next 30 minutes, is it a safe place? And you could interpret that in a way like that could mean it's just a stagnant, safe place, or it's not, you know, or has been, you know, maybe it has been for the last few hours. Maybe it will be for the next few hours. You don't really know. So there is always going to be a bit of a vagueness to this whole thing. So with that said, the result you get is a wheel, which is good. It means effectively, yes, that in the very immediate future, the current state of things, you will have success in such a thing. And that might not be much for you as a player, but I would hope it means a whole lot as a character. At least with hope, considering hope.
Yeah.
For the listeners, James is drinking a very large drink right now.
Did you want some lemonade with that vodka?
Yeah, it looks like a liter of Mike's Hard.
Yeah.
It's a liter of water with like a lemon lime nun tablet in it. It's to help replenish electrolytes because I'm just sweating over here.
And weeping uncontrollably on mute.
Also that, yes.
Yeah, if you hear a vague wailing in the background throughout this recording.
Occasional. We swear it's not the Uncharted North Banshee. It is James. It is definitely James.
You might be closer than you may think to my next character.
Also, if you want to learn about banshees, check out Encounter This on the Uncharted.
We covered that forever ago, and it was a very, very fun episode. It really was. All right. You have waited till nightfall a bit. I'm going to call it around 7 o'clock now. Let's call it 8. The stars are nice and out. And you leave Rinz?
Yes.
Yes.
She leaves you. You have one last cup of tea, and she leaves you hoping that she's calmed you in some capacity. And you can see that she's guilt-ridden, you know? She's struggling being this member of, or this part, being a part of this whole thing and unable to help.
I think that on the way out, Tulok, though this may be out of character for him and her, gives her a hug and then departs.
Yeah, she kind of like shies away at first. It's very unexpected, and it's something that she's definitely not used to. You could tell she appreciates it, and she does give you an embrace back to a degree. And then she gives Krukka a pat on the head and a rub on the tummy as he leaves.
And he makes a nice little Pillsbury doughboy, like, woohoo! I tried to do that in Krukka's voice, but couldn't. Like, woohoo!
There you go.
Amazing. And you leave Rinz. And as you leave Rinz, you are quickly stopped by a courier. Master Tulok! Oh, I heard you were in town.
Yes. What do you have?
Well, your package has arrived. Oh, a letter. And a package for Lady Gilda.
Ooh, what's the return policy?
My heart, right through my heart.
Jesus Christ.
Sorry, I was sitting on that one for a while.
I guess we got the episode title.
How do I apply for an RMA? Oh, God.
Dunk, you dirty dog.
Oh, vicious.
He does not actually say that, but...
But he sure does think it.
Good joke. okay, so where was I? The courier hands Tulok a letter and then says, "You can pick the package up over at Galentine. You know the deal. Thanks, Master Tulok. You're a real hero." It just peels off full speed. And we're going to do a little flashback here to a couple of days ago. where on a warm afternoon, the sun shines upon the stone steps of a humble two-story structure. And a man upon his horse dismounts and passes through the door. A sign above swings slightly in the breeze, and it says, "The Della Reese Inn." Moving through the door and into a large dining area, there are two women bustling around, apparently getting ready for what is likely the dinner rush.
"I'll be with you shortly. Sit anywhere you'd like," the older of the two women shouts over her shoulder as she scrubs a table.
The stranger ignores this request and heads straight in her direction, and stiffening at his quick approach, the woman wheels around. "Express delivery from Otari." The man hands her an envelope. Startled, her brow creases as she receives it, taking a deep breath, and she looks upon the wax seal.
"Oh, Mum, a letter?"
The younger woman rushes up behind her.
"Who's it from?" "Hush, Aileen. I haven't even opened it."
Examining the envelope, it's plain on the front, the wax seal that is black. She flips it over and her blood runs cold. She recognizes the letters on the seal, DR. In tidy calligraphy, hand-carved into the wax, to be that of her son.
"Galt, come, quick! It's a letter from Gav!"
A clatter of plates is heard from the kitchen as a handsome older man comes bursting out of a swinging door.
"Come, Renee, what does it say?"
Rushing towards the two women. And with a deep breath, the older woman, Renee, nervously brushes her hair back behind her pointed ears, cracking the wax and withdrawing the neatly folded letter. And it reads,
"Dear family, I know it has been some time since my last letter. Years, in fact. The time seems to pass like the short days of winter. But the last few weeks have felt as if ages have passed. To see me now, after these 10 years, you may not even recognize me. I live in Otari, not far, but it has been a place of peace for me until recently. Pure evil has descended upon this town, and I have been irreversibly intertwined in this evil. The powers of an ancient sorceress named Bella Cora Horovex have been dormant for many centuries below a lighthouse in the Fog Fen. Now these sick powers have been freed in the depths, with waves of undead being unleashed upon the town. I've been diving into the vaults below the lighthouse to try and save Otari, each level more disturbing than the last. In a private room dedicated to the destruction of Absalom, I found a list of names. Targets, I believe. The list includes our name, our family name. I implore you, do you know of any connection? Perhaps Grandma and Grandpa would have known or mentioned something. Please, any information you have is of the utmost importance. Find out what you can, take the gold pieces, and return the letter express. Every moment counts. I've lost multiple friends already, and this information could help us greatly. I hope Aileen is well. Don't come find me. Love, Gav."
The letter in your hand now is the response. I've put it in your inventory. Do you want me to read it, or do you want to cold read it?
Tulok will read it.
Yeah.
Does he want Crooked to read it?
He is very well read, you know.
Tulok takes the letter, cracks the wax, and his heart begins to beat faster as he opens it. "It's from my father, Krukka. It says, my dearest son, it gives my heart great joy to know you're still with us. Your mother has wept with joy and sadness at your letter, and Aileen is furious with you. though I can tell she is relieved to know you are alive. We are proud and full of fear with the news of danger and evil, and the fact you face it. I don't fully understand why you've left, but knowing what you may be doing does bring me some clarity, I think. How our family name is connected, I cannot say. However, my grandfather mentioned the Horovex family to me once before. He was a cheerful, hardworking man. I do not remember how it came up, but I never forgot how he soured on the topic. All that I can recall is that the Horovexes had a moment of tremendous notoriety when they were caught doing dark and hidden things in Absalom and were expelled and exiled from the Isle of Kortos. If you think it necessary, I could ask around some, though I am no longer fit to fight against such an evil, and I fear Aileen would get herself into trouble if I allowed her to investigate. I've been giving her extra chores and excuses to keep her at home, but she's grown anxious and suspicious. Please, do not worry for us as we do for you. You are loved, and you always have a home. Your loving father. And Tulok silently folds the letter and slides it back in his pocket.
I almost jokingly wrote, P.S. I'm going to need 2 gold because this is really expensive to expedite. But that was before I remembered that you sent the gold with it to send a letter back.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's it. Right. I knew. I know what my father's like.
Yeah.
Well, it must be nice to have a father. He sounds lovely.
Tough crowd.
Damn. It's awfully presumptuous to think that Tulok showed you the letter.
Oh, he was just standing there reading it silently after he said, Tulok, it's a letter from my father. Dead silence.
Oh, fair enough. Yeah, that's fair. Yeah. My bad.
So basically, we got nothing from that other than the fact he might ask around.
I mean, he awaits your response, I guess, in a way. But yeah, he didn't have any information for you. But
well,
what you
yeah.
here's what you
find
know.
Find it out.
Sort of. Is that, you know, like Raphael, this is going way back now. Raphael has gone to Absalom to find out more. We have not.
Yes.
We've not explored that yet. I hope to one day. And hopefully it gets involved. But that's where you're at now. You know.
She's on a Gandalf fest.
Stunning for your family to hear from you, you know, at this point. And they don't know much. But your dad is careful, cautious, and scared, but wants to help if he can. So that's on you. Still have a lot of adventure to go, Scott. Don't rush it.
I know.
Do you head to the Galentine deliveries as well?
Yeah. I mean, we're very close to it, so might as well.
All right, so you loop around the corner, around from Rin's to Galentine deliveries, and it's, you know... It does tend to be open a little bit later. Sometimes, you know, packages come in the middle of the night. So there's not a lot of couriers bustling around, but the office is nearly always open. And you step in into the sort of stark candlelit room or like lantern-lit room with packages all over the place in different cubby holes and areas and all labeled and such. And Aloria Galentine herself is behind the counter. Calendar? Behind the counter. Jesus. Words. And she says,
Oh, Master Tulok. Welcome. Welcome. We have a package for Lady Gilda.
Tulok approaches and says, Well... suppose I should tell you now, and perhaps you could tell the others, as I do not wish to continue talking about it at the moment. The Lady Gilda has fallen deep underground, and we go now to try to retrieve her body. Thank you for your efforts, but it came too late.
I am very sorry to hear that. That is a hero of the graveyard event in the night of the full moon.
saved many lives here on Otari, including some of my couriers. That is the saddest news I've heard since Samara's death.
It's rude.
You say
it's fucking rude.
I didn't say it was sadder than Samal's death. I said it was the saddest since Samal's death.
Yeah, but what about physics?
Yeah, nobody died since then.
Yeah, there wasn't anyone in between there. There was a local.
Oh, that back alley surgeon? Oh, no. Now, he was always cavorting with them there Thieves Guild members, the Osprey Club, a real unsavory sort. No, that's not all there
is. Listeners, get him in the Discord.
There are so many less people just walking around bleeding now.
Very sadly and somberly, she hands you the package.
Well, I don't know what exactly to do with this, but... I suppose it's a rifle of yours as the other heroes of Otari. I could always send a letter to her father. Free of charge, of course. If you'd like, I could write something up. Or I could ask the mayor. Or you could give me something if you like. But I'm sorry. I just don't know what to do or say.
When we come back with her body in hand, then we will reach out to her father. Until that moment, we will not reach out to him. We will not speak to him. We will not send word. Because I will not let him know until she is back from that evil place.
I understand.
So I can message Chima's voice up real quick.
You up?
He's wearing a black t-shirt, right?
I like the idea of Tulak taking that ye old 8th level Bastion dip.
just a shield in the corner of the room with magic missiles coming out behind it.
Tulak's too weak to hold the shield.
Yeah, just put it at an angle against a wall and hide underneath it.
He's just like dragging it around.
Just uses it as like a sled down some stairs. That's about it.
I said take Unseen Servant to carry it around in front of me.
So Aloria hands you the shield. Was it the sturdy shield? Moderate or something? I forget. James, you can let us know.
Moderate sturdy shield.
Yeah, this beefed up sturdy shield. and as she does, she says,
"I suppose I should I should direct you in this direction, too."
She points across the room to someone who's sitting on a bench, sort of just waiting and contemplating.
This person came in with the delivery today. She knew Samal. And she said something along the lines of, being here to finish his business. Mayhaps you can help her better than I can.
And Tulak's eyes look up immediately, because he didn't know Samal for long, but he certainly knew of Azori. And he thinks that the only her that he's ever heard about in his life was Azori.
And James, you want to describe what this person looks like waiting here in the delivery room? That's not the right word.
It's a boy and it's yours.
Azori isn't, she's not an imposing woman like Gilda was. Like, she's not strong. And nor is she like traditionally beautiful, but she has this dark olive complexion that has been roughened by a life at sea. She's got long black hair with a few strands of silver running through it. And she almost always has on a smile, which noticeably stretches the skin around her eyes, reflecting a life well lived. She has this bright purple and gilded doublet. And under that, you can see that she's got a very thin frame, but very muscular, very lithe. And one of the things you'll notice when she's on land is she actually moves a little awkwardly because she has cultivated a grace from decades at sea that does not translate to a stable land. Attached to her side is a very, very ornate rapier, like probably too ornate for being this far out. But it also instills a little bit of fear in you. Maybe it's the shine, maybe it's the way the metal absorbs the light, but something about it just doesn't sit well. Same with her doublet. Maybe it's the purple or the folds or the way the shadows are absorbed, but there's just something that makes you feel a little uncomfortable around her. Other than that, she looks like a perfectly normal early 50s woman.
Tulok turns towards her. Sorry, is that you?
The accent. The clothes. You must be the Sage Tulok.
That's right. Small spoke of you. Not as much as I would have liked. We knew each other, though not as well as I would have liked before he fell. But he spoke of you with care.
She stands and crosses the room to Luck and Krukka. And you are exactly as his letters have described. Physic is much bigger than I would have expected based on what he had said. But yes, you guess correct. I am Izori Alamtsin Lansir. It is a pleasure to make your acquaintance.
I have no idea who any of these people are.
So Tulok bows to Izori and he says, well, much has happened since your last letter from Samal. Physic has fallen. This is Krukka, our newest companion. And Krukka, this is our old companion Samal's.
She smiles at your pause.
Izori.
Yes, I am his Izori, and that probably describes me the best. He was my everything, my guiding star, my fate. And I like to believe that I was his as well.
We have just lost another friend. Lady Gilda of August. She fell in the Abomination Vault, and we were preparing ourselves to go back to retrieve her corpse. You've met us at a dark moment, amongst many dark moments.
Yes, I can tell. The darkness, it sits upon you like a cloak. But my rapier glimmers in the light. I am here to finish what my Samal saw so fit to start, but like the clumsy oaf he was, could not finish. I appreciate the friendship you gave him, Sage Tulok, and I would like to help finish what he has started.
Well, we already have a clumsy oaf, but we can use whatever help you can provide.
Yeah, Tulok.
Come on,
and Tulok thinks Krukka is talking about himself, but yeah, he's talking about Tulok.
I got a +4 dex, biatch.
I mean, that used to be high.
Oh.
Got his ass.
Wait, what's that supposed to mean? You're only a +4.
Yeah, I know. I know. I just wanted to instigate a fight immediately.
Well, you obviously have your new companion. I am personally extremely excited to see how this party dynamic works.
Poorly. It's going to work poorly. I built this character for after Tulok's death.
Yeah, but really neat.
Oh, I've been looking through your character sheet, and man, first of all, your items sick, and spells sick, Are you going to let the listeners know what you're working with here? What, like, class or anything like that, or?
I didn't think about it, but I definitely can if that's the way we want to play it.
I think we should save it. I think next episode we'll dive in. I want everyone to have level 8 ready.
Okay.
Which is a
just got level 7 ready.
Anyone okay. else? Yeah, yeah. Have level 8 ready. Everyone gets a hero point. James gets another hero point just because I killed him because I feel bad.
Everyone well, I already started with one, yeah. So does that give me
yeah,
three?
No, you start with one. You start with one. You get one because I feel bad. And Scott and Duncan get one for all the roleplay in this episode. And then, James, you also get one for thinking Krukka is an oversized physic.
I mean, he died before Physic died. There's no reason she would know anything about Krukka.
No, it's true. Yeah,
even gold. Raphael left before Physic died, so...
So if everyone had none, effectively, then, you know, Duncan and Scott, you have two. Lady Gilda. Shit, that's going to suck. Azori has three. Azori has three. And that is where we're going to call it.
And listeners, you're in the dark, you freaks.
Stemming the Tide is an actual play podcast of the Adventure Path Abomination Vaults and is produced by the Uncharted North Network. Stemming the Tide uses trademarks and or copyrights owned by Paizo Inc., used under Paizo's community use policy. We are expressly prohibited from charging you to use or access this content. Stemming the Tide is not published, endorsed, or specifically approved by Paizo. For more information about Paizo Inc. and Paizo products, visit paizo.com. Music is composed by Will Savino and artwork by Greyhood. Stemming the Tide is recorded remotely using Foundry Virtual Tabletop. If you wish to connect with us or support this project and projects to come, we can be found at unchartednorth.ca, patreon.com/unchartednorth, and on all major social media platforms. Links to all credits can be found in the episode description and our website. Thanks for tuning in.